Acts chapter 12. It was about this time that King Herod arrested some who belonged to the church, intending to persecute them. He had James, the brother of John, put to death with the sword. When he saw that this met with approval among the Jews, he proceeded to seize Peter also. This happened during the festival of unleavened bread. After arresting him, he put him in prison, handing him over to be guarded by four squads of four soldiers each. Herod intended to bring him out for public trial after the Passover. So Peter was kept in prison, but the church was earnestly praying to God for him. The night before Herod was to bring him to trial, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers, bound with two chains, and sentries stood guard at the entrance. Suddenly, an angel of the Lord appeared, and a light shone in the cell. He struck Peter on the side and woke him up. "Quick, get up," he said, and the chains fell off Peter's wrists. Then the angel said to him, "Put on your clothes and sandals," and Peter did so. "Wrap your cloak around you and follow me," the angel told him. Peter followed him out of the prison, but he had no idea what the angel was doing was really happening. He thought he was seeing a vision. They passed the first and second guards and came to the iron gate leading to the city. It opened for them by itself, and they went through it. When they had walked the length of one street, suddenly the angel left him. Then Peter came to himself and said, "Now I know without a doubt that the Lord has sent his angel and rescued me from Herod's clutches and from everything the Jewish people were hoping would happen." When this had dawned on him, he went to the house of Mary, the mother of John, also called Mark, where many people had gathered and were praying. Peter knocked at the outer entrance, and a servant named Rhoda came to answer the door. When she recognized Peter's voice, she was so overjoyed, she ran back without opening it and exclaimed, "Peter is at the door." "You're out of your mind," they told her. When she kept insisting that it was so, they said, "It must be his angel." But Peter kept on knocking, and when they opened the door and saw him, they were astonished. Peter motioned with his hand for them to be quiet and described how the Lord had brought him out of prison. "Tell James and the other brothers and sisters about this," he said, and then he left for another place. In the morning, there was no small commotion amongst the soldiers as to what had become of Peter. After Herod had a thorough search made for him and did not find him, he cross-examined the guards and ordered that they be executed. Then Herod went from Judea to Caesarea and stayed there. He had been quarreling with the people of Tyre and Sidon. They now joined together and sought an audience with him. After securing the support of Blastus, a trusted personal servant of the king, they asked for peace because they depended on the king's country for their food supply. On the appointed day, Herod, wearing his royal robe, sat on his throne and delivered a public address to the people. They shouted, "This is the voice of a god, not a man." Immediately, because Herod did not give praise to God, an angel of the Lord struck him down, and he was eaten by worms and died. But the word of God continued to spread and flourish.
Thanks very much, Sarah. Please keep the passage open in front of you. I think it's fair to say it's one of the most astonishing and bizarre passages, definitely in Acts, maybe the whole Bible. So please keep it open. And you might find it helpful as well to follow along in the service sheets you were given. On the inside, there's an outline of where we're going. As has been said already, my name is James. Lovely to be able to see you this morning. And again, a particular welcome to those guests of the Pepiat families and Pepiat and Brocken families. Lovely to have you here with us. I hope you have a great day in Southampton. Persecution, opposition, marginalization. These are things that Christians throughout history, around the world, have always been familiar with. Persecution. Last year, 2022, more than 5,600 Christians were killed for their faith worldwide. Now, none of those deaths took place in this country. Praise God for the legal freedoms we still enjoy here. But opposition? Marginalization? Yeah, we certainly experience our fair share of that, don't we? Today's chapter in Acts is all about opposition to the Christian faith. And the reason it's here in the Bible is because we need to know that anyone who follows Jesus needs to expect opposition. Whether that's as seasoned believers or perhaps those just weighing up the cost of following Jesus, we need to expect opposition as part of the deal, and we need to know how to handle it. Liam and Emily, Josh and Jenny, I know that the Thanksgiving promises you've just made, that we've all just made, in fact, they don't explicitly mention opposition to faith, which is probably just as well today. But I guess those commitments that you did make, teaching the Christian faith to Martha and to Daniel, modeling the Christian life to them, bringing them up in the discipline and instruction of the Lord, somewhere in those things is going to be passing on the reality that opposition is just part of the deal. Even as I'm sure that's not the priority for this particular day. Now, as we come to Acts chapter 12, it's, in fact, hard to imagine things in the story of Acts so far being more exciting and optimistic. Jesus had said all along, right at the start of Acts, that the gospel, his message of repentance, turning back to God, and forgiveness of sins, he said that message was just going to explode worldwide. That's back in chapter 1, verse 8. Recently in the book of Acts, that has begun to come to fruition. Jesus has persuaded the apostle Peter that the gospel, it really is for non-Jews, not just for Jews. No extra qualifications necessary. You can be forgiven, whoever you are. The path is open to worldwide expansion, and the church in the city of Antioch, a non-Jewish city, last week if you were here, we saw it's the first example of a non-Jewish church. So we hit chapter 12 full of excitement. There's huge potential. We feel like we're on the cusp of something astonishing. But opposition is never far away. And in chapter 12, verse 1, it's put front and center. Verse 1, it was about this time that King Herod arrested some who belonged to the church, intending to persecute them. So this is the Herod it's talking about, is Herod Agrippa I, real historical figure. I think we've got a mugshot. There we are. It's fair to say he was a bit of a megalomaniac. So he decides to persecute some of this fledgling church in Jerusalem. Perhaps he's wanting to get the Jews on side. Herod himself was sort of an outsider, so that might have been politically sensible. Maybe he wants to show who's the real king of the Jews. It's me, not Jesus. And he decides to persecute. He does it. It's easy. Verse 2, he takes James, the brother of John, so this is one of the 12 apostles, executes him, just like that. And he gets egged on afterwards by some of the non-believing Jews in Jerusalem, so he decides, okay, I'll aim a bit higher. Verse 3, who's the leader of this Christianity movement at the moment? Peter, chief apostle? Yeah, okay. The manhunt is on. Doesn't last long. Peter is seized, locked up, high security jail, rotating special ops security detail. A date is set for the trial, but it's clear which way it's going to go. What must this have felt like to live through in the early church? Just imagine the horror, the instability, the feeling of, have we just been naive all this time? Think of the tragedy of losing friends, the fear for your own life, the questioning, Lord, what are you doing? But just notice, verse 3, this all took place in the festival of Passover. The festival celebrating, remember, the greatest escape in world history? Israel's miraculous escape from the clutches of Pharaoh, another megalomaniac, hunting down the Lord's people. And now, for the early church, the festival of Passover has been repurposed as well, celebrating not just an escape from death in Egypt, but the defeat of death itself in the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. So that history, ancient and so recent, ringing in the early church's ears, would have given them some measure of hope, you might think. It's no surprise, then, to read verse 5. Peter was kept in prison, but the church was earnestly praying to God for him. So the scene is set for the great escape. Verse 6. Date, the night before Peter's trial. Location, Peter's jail cell. It's late, it's dark, it's quiet. At the door, there's two special forces soldiers. The wall opposite the door in the cell, two more soldiers, manacles on their wrists, chained either side to the Apostle Peter. This is highest level security. It's way over the top numbers of guards. It's almost like Herod expects something to happen, but it couldn't, surely, not with this level of protection. And Peter himself doesn't seem particularly in the mood for an escape. I mean, look at him, he's fast asleep. But then, verse 7, blinding light, an angel just materializes, gives Peter like a shove on the shoulder. Hey, get up! Peter wakes up, bleary-eyed, doesn't seem particularly awake. What's this, an angel? Chains off? Oh, sure. The angel in verse 8 is hurrying Peter along. Come on, clothes on, sandals on, got your cloak? Let's go. And then they just start to walk out of the cell. At this point, it doesn't say what's going on with the guards. In my mind, it's one of two options. Either they've been like taken out by the blast of light and they're just sort of stupefied, slumped on the floor. Or, I sort of prefer this option, maybe they're still standing there, just sort of unfazed by any of it, staring blankly into the middle distance, like, this is not the apostle you're looking for. That's a Star Wars reference. Either way, the angel leads Peter straight out of the cell, absolutely no difficulty, they just walk. Peter's still not totally with it. It says he had no idea that what the angel was doing was really happening. He thought he was seeing a vision. So I got this image of Peter walking along the prison corridor here, sort of looking a bit puzzled. I wonder what this vision might represent. Is it a metaphor or a simile? Is this the Lord maybe reassuring me that I'll soon be released from this earthly life to be with him forever? So they go on like this, right through the outer courtyard, then the reinforced iron-barred gate leading to freedom just swings open on its own. The angel sweeps through and off into the street, into the darkness. Peter's sort of trotting along behind. And then suddenly, end of verse 11, the angel disappears. And Peter's like, oh, vision over. Very interesting. Guess I'll wake up in a moment, be back in my cell. Guess I'll wake up in a moment. And then verse 11, Peter came to himself and said, and at this point, I think he gets first prize for stating the obvious. Now I know without a doubt that the Lord has sent his angel and rescued me from Herod's clutches and from everything the Jewish people were hoping would happen. Yes, Peter, he has. Now hurry up and get off the streets before you get found. So he does. Verse 12, he sneaks off to the house of Mary, the mother of John, also called Mark. This is, by the way, that's the same Mark who we think wrote the Gospel of Mark. So his mum. It seems like this place was probably one of the main hangouts for the early Christians in Jerusalem. There are loads of people there, all having an all-night prayer vigil for Peter. So there they are inside, begging the Lord to intervene and rescue Peter. Oh, Rhoda, would you get that, please? Off Rhoda goes to the door. They carry on praying. Then there's a shriek from the corridor, running feet. Rhoda reappears. Everyone looks up. What's going on? Has Herod come for us too? No. It's Peter. Peter, everyone. Peter's right outside the door. You're mad, Rhoda. What are you talking about? Who is it really? No, really. It's Peter's voice outside. Just come and listen. Okay, maybe it's his angel. When they say maybe it's his angel in verse 15, I don't know what they mean. They might mean like a guardian angel. Or maybe they think Peter's already died and maybe this is his spirit visiting them or something. The point is, they seem to assume anything is more likely than Peter having been rescued and standing outside the door. All the while, Peter is standing there outside. I don't know why Rhoda didn't just open the door in the first place and let him in. He's still knocking, looking over his shoulder perhaps to see if anyone has discovered him yet and sort of whisper shouting, "Hello, anyone?" Inside, Rhoda's absolutely beside herself. The prayer meeting derailed. Eventually, Someone decides to get up and actually open the door. Finally, in bursts Peter. Shocked silence, and then pandemonium. People shouting, breaking into song. There's chairs knocked over in the scramble to get him and hug him. And then there's a hush as Peter's like, whoa, 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 everyone, I'm on the run, keep it down. So verse 17, they sit down and Peter begins to explain, you'll hardly believe this. The Lord has just come through for us in the most amazing way. So I was just sat on the bench sleeping. And he tells the story. And then off he goes to hide somewhere else. And Luke very cleverly doesn't tell us where. Can you imagine being in that room when Peter told that story? Hearing about the way the Lord has answered the boldest of your prayers so miraculously. Seeing Peter there in front of you when you thought the next time you were going to see him was tomorrow on the block. Imagine what this would do for your faith, your assurance, your confidence in the Lord Jesus in times of crisis going forwards. And this is meant to have the same effect on us today, even so long afterwards. This is the sort of thing the Lord Jesus can do. He has done it. He continues to, whenever he wants. If you perhaps read our book of the term in the summer term, The Hiding Place, Corrie ten Boom's biography, it's a Christian lady who sheltered Jews from the Nazis in the Second World War. You'll have read about some of the ways that the Lord still is miraculously at work in times of terrible opposition. Any number of other biographies, perhaps even in your own life, as you think back. Miraculous things don't always seem miraculous until perhaps you tell it to someone else. Those apparent coincidences that happen so often in tandem with a very specific prayer. And there's simply no other plausible explanation. I don't know what you make of it when you read about miracles like this one in the Bible. Maybe there's an inner skeptic in your mind who just pops up right about now with lines like, yeah, but these things don't actually happen, do they? Surely there's another explanation. Two things that we can say to our inner skeptics. One, our author Luke, he wrote the book of Acts to chronicle the ongoing acts of Jesus Christ, the King of the universe, after he returns to heaven. Now, if Jesus is the King of the universe, I would say it would be weird not to have this sort of event taking place. This is exactly what you would expect to find if the King of the universe is doing something in his world. Two, this particular miracle is so believable because of the total ineptitude of Peter and basically every other character in the story. I mean, if you were making up this story, you'd have the angel, yeah? You'd have the chains popping off, you'd have the guards neutralized. You would not have Peter, the main guy, behaving like an absolute numpty, thinking the whole thing was a dream. You would not have this servant girl, Rhoda, forgetting to open the door to him. What a weird detail to make up. And you definitely wouldn't have the early church praying earnestly in verse 5 for Peter's release, presumably, then wanting to believe anything, no matter how bizarre, other than the Lord has actually answered their prayers. I find it completely compelling that none of the characters expect the miracle to happen. Conclusion, it did happen. So Jesus pulls off the great escape. But then again, just like in that first great escape, the first Exodus, it's not really finished until the megalomaniac is dealt with and everybody knows who the true king really is. So let's finish off the story more briefly in verses 18 to 23 before we try and draw out some lessons for us from the whole episode. So point two, the true king. Can you just imagine the chaos King Herod has to deal with the next morning in verse 18, the PR nightmare? The most important political prisoner of your entire career has just disappeared. Your top security guys have no idea what's happened. And you've got this massive crowd just outside the door baying for Peter's blood. Nightmare. So, like any politician with nous, Herod deflects the blame. Verse 19, he sends the guards off to be executed, which, by the way, shows us just from another angle how ruthless this guy is. He gets out of Jerusalem quick. He goes up the coast to Caesarea, decides to just lay low for a little while. And now Luke then fast forwards a few months to Herod's next political outing, his next major public appearance. Verse 20, some of his subjects from the cities of Tyre and Sidon have been protesting, and Herod's been sort of flexing his muscles by cutting off their food supply. So the Tyre and Sidonians decide to cut their losses and just try and make peace with Herod. A meeting is set up, Herod's going to give a speech, everyone's going to be nice and flattering to him, and hopefully they'll all make friends. That's the plan. Verse 21, Herod shows up, he's decked out in all his regalia. Think coronation level stuff. And he sits down on this throne, or his judgment seat, that could be translated. And as he begins his speech, the people start to flatter him. Verse 21, this is the voice of a god, not of a man. And maybe there was a brief moment where Herod thought to himself, yes, I've made it. Yes, thank you. Wearing the most impressive clothes money can buy, these people just in the palm of my hand, sitting on the judgment seat over them. Do you know what? Maybe I am a god. I can do whatever I like. But it was just a brief moment. Verse 23, immediately, because Herod did not give praise to God, an angel of the Lord, second angel in the story, interestingly, an angel of the Lord struck him down, and he was eaten by worms and died. Mid-speech, apparently, he just collapses, clutching his stomach. Can you imagine the moment? Officials running on stage, hands to the earpieces, the crowd kind of pressing in to see what's happened, medics rushing around, stretcher appearing, Herod being carried off in a hush. We read in the history books, he's bedbound for 5 days in complete agony, and then he dies. The pride, the hubris of this man, deliberately and systematically picking off the people of God, James, Peter, beginning to think he could accept praise for God, beginning to think perhaps he was God. What did he expect was going to happen? Just like Pharaoh, just like any other megalomaniac you can think of, Nebuchadnezzar, Haman, when you play God, when you set yourself up against the people of God, what do you expect is going to happen? So Luke concludes the chapter and this whole section of Acts with the refrain, the kind of repeated idea that comes up again and again in this book, the refrain actually that could describe all of human history ever since then, but the word of God continued to spread and flourish. Luke wants us to know, to understand, to believe that Jesus' message spreads regardless of opposition. It did then, it still does. Jesus' message of forgiveness and life, the gospel, it spreads regardless of opposition. As I said, I just want to spend a few minutes as we finish drawing out some lessons from this episode. In particular, lessons for when the going gets tough, for when we face opposition in the Christian life. First lesson, we have to realize opposition is normal. I feel like Christians I know, and myself, I guess, sort of swing between two extremes when it comes to our perception of the opposition we face right now in this country. So one end of the spectrum, oh, we don't really face opposition in this country. There are no martyrdoms. It's not like Nigeria or North Korea. Well, okay, true. Yeah, we don't currently face death for our faith. Praise the Lord. Other end of the spectrum that people go towards, every generation of the church has had its challenges from the society it finds itself in, perhaps especially this generation. That's what other people say. Okay, also sort of true. there are unique challenges facing us, particularly, I guess, when it comes to ideologies, things about surrounding sexuality and gender, perhaps the new religion of secular society, which in so many ways is set up explicitly against Jesus and his rule. But actually, I'm not sure either of these positions can be quite right, the no opposition end and the especially now end. One of the main reasons Acts is in the Bible is to persuade us that opposition to the Christian faith is par for the course. So sure, it manifests itself in different ways, from martyrdom through to job loss that we have begun to see in this country, right down to the kind of poking fun that all of us have experienced. It's all opposition. But any form of opposition can take its toll. You'll know that firsthand. You know, if you've ever said anything that doesn't sound 100% affirming, perhaps to those ideologies in the workplace, I think probably it's our young people who are on the front line in that particular challenge. But then what about the especially in this generation thing? So I mean, have Daniel and Martha been spectacularly unlucky to be born right now in 2023? Well, if the Lord answers our prayers and they do come to have their own personal faith in the Lord Jesus, then yes, they will face challenges and opposition. Unique challenges, yes. But I hope this is reassuring for those families and for all of us. I don't know if I quite buy into the especially now thing. I mean, when you read Acts, it looks pretty bad. When you read other eras of church history, it looks pretty bad too. As far as I can tell, these whole 2,000 years of church history, Christians have always thought their generation had it worst. I don't know if I buy that. Opposition is always there. It looks different. It'll look different in Eswatini to the UK, sure. But it is always there. We need to know that it's normal. When new ideologies dominate, that does not mean Jesus has stopped being king. When laws are passed to keep our mouths shut, that does not mean we should stop speaking. When the shame hits you because suddenly everyone at work or school has realized, oh, you're that sort of Christian? You believe that? That doesn't mean anything has gone wrong. Opposition comes and goes. Tyrants rise and fall. Ideologies come in and out of fashion. Through it all, Jesus is still king, and he oversees their ultimate downfall. Which leads to the next lesson, trust the real leader. I don't know if you realize this, there are actually two leadership showdowns in our passage. So there's one obvious one, Herod, king of the Jews, versus Jesus, king of the Jews, the real one. It's just enormously comforting to see quite how easy it is for Jesus to show his immense strength when he wants to. Those angels walking Peter out of jail like he's got the cheat codes to the game, striking Herod down right at the apex of his career. If Jesus wants to show that power on the world stage, he can whenever he wants. Putin could be gone just like that. The pressure you're getting now for being openly Christian could be gone just like that. One day it will be. But the other leadership showdown is more subtle. It's between Jesus and Peter. So remember who Peter is? You are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, said Jesus, Matthew 16, 18. Now, we're not even halfway through the book of Acts, but this chapter is effectively the last time we see Peter. There's one other minor reference in chapter 15. That's a bit weird. I thought Peter was the main guy. Just think of one or two Christian leaders who've been really influential in your own life, if you can think of anyone like that. What impact would it have on you if suddenly, for whatever reason, they weren't there anymore? God forbid, of course. But if they suddenly, I don't know, caught a life-changing illness, or had to stand down from ministry, or got put in prison like Peter, perhaps, just for preaching the gospel. Now, some of you might not have to imagine this, of course, these things happen. But just think, what kind of impact might that have on you if that kind of opposition arose? The two or three people I'm thinking of who've been really instrumental in my own Christian life, if they were taken out, I think I might be quite rocked, to be honest. I need to learn to trust that the real leader is King Jesus. Put myself in his hands, and perhaps you do too. This chapter helps us. I mean, Peter has done some pretty extraordinary stuff as an apostle. He even, I don't know if you remember this, he raised a girl from the dead back in chapter 9. None of my three people have ever done that. For anyone who was perhaps tempted to trust Peter more than Jesus back in those days, chapter 12 is a reality check. It pulls back the curtain and shows us who is actually the impressive one to trust. Jesus pulling the strings from heaven. Jesus, the one engineering the great escape. Jesus virtually dressing a sleepwalking Peter. I think it's okay to laugh at Peter being a bit dopey in this story. It's funny, Jesus wants us to realize Peter is just a bit of a dopey guy, used spectacularly by the Lord. But don't trust Peter, trust Jesus. The leaders you look up to, thank God for them. But remember, they're probably just dopey human beings after all. Trust Jesus. Final lesson, very briefly. Pray big. Feels like our cultural climate hovers somewhere between indifference to Christianity and hostility towards it. Question, how does that affect your prayer life? Temptation, I think, is to just dial back our prayers, probably a bit of a defense mechanism. Aim lower in what we ask for, so we're less likely to be disappointed. When was the last time you prayed for a wholesale cultural swing back to the Lord? For the churches in Southampton to be filled? For people on your street to come to faith, not just come to a carol service? The early church here prayed big for Peter's release. And remember, the Apostle James had been killed back in verse 2. I guess they'd prayed for his release, and the Lord hadn't answered in that case. It would have been tempting for them to dial back their prayers, wouldn't it? They didn't, and this time the Lord did answer. And the encouraging thing about this is that the faith they had when they prayed a big prayer for Peter, their faith was clearly pretty mixed. Peter was standing at the door and they didn't believe it. That says to me, we have permission to pray big prayers, crazy prayers. And if we're not quite convinced it's actually going to happen, that's okay. Pray it anyway. The Lord uses the imperfect prayers of his imperfect people. He did it back then, he can again. The good news of Jesus spreads regardless of opposition. Opposition is normal. Trust the real leader and pray big. Shall we pray now? Thank you, Father, for this astonishing show of the power of the Lord Jesus. We pray that you would increase our faith in him. Especially as the going gets tough in whatever circumstances we find ourselves. In Jesus' name, amen.